I was raised in an evangelical Presbyterian church, and we had an emphasis on evangelizing. There were often disagreements of between various churches in Cincinnati about should the emphasis be on evangelizing, going door to door, teaching people how to evangelize, or really should we be doing works of mercy, caring for people and their immediate visible needs? Was it the gospel or was it the social gospel? And in some ways, it's kind of coming full circle as you hear some of the evangelical churches emphasizing being a deeds church. And, you know, maybe we shouldn't talk so much about the Lord, we should just be his hands and feet. We knew that sharing the truth about the Lord had to fit with caring for others, because James 2:15 and 16 says, if a brother or sister is ill-clad and in lack of daily food, and one of you says, go in peace, be warmed and filled, without giving them the things needed for the body, what does it profit? But at the same time, should our focus be primarily caring for their bodies, which only will live for a brief amount of time, or caring for their souls, which will last for eternity? And the beautiful thing is that the Catholic way is both and. We need to do both. Pope Francis says this: Jesus introduces us to these works of mercy in his preaching so that we can know whether or not we are living as his disciples, end quote. Jesus is the evangelist of mercy, and he draws people to himself through both his words and his deeds. The spiritual works of mercy focus more on the words, and the corporal works of mercy focus more on the deeds, and Jesus invites us to imitate him. So we're going to go through, if you're taking notes, sorry I don't have an outline, but we're going to go through the seven spiritual works of mercy and then the seven corporal works of mercy. And I hope as we go through them, other illustrations will come to your heart and your mind, because we're all seeking to live this, right? We all have different makeup in our family. Some of us have very tiny children. Some of us are at the grandparent or great-grandparent stage. And I hope that as you get ideas, you might consider sharing them with me and sharing them with each other, because the Holy Spirit just works in this wonderful way, individually responding, helping us to respond to this word. And I know that you'll have many other illustrations than what I have. So number one spiritual work of mercy is admonish sinners. When Jesus meets up with Levi, the tax collector, he says, let's go to your home. And he ends up at Levi's home. Levi becomes Matthew, and he's surrounded by sinners, public sinners, as Brent Petrie was teaching us the other night. And from the outside, it looks like Jesus is keeping pretty shady company. And his comment back to those who would judge him in Luke 5:32 is, I have not come to call the righteous but sinners to repentance. And that's always a little tongue-in-cheek, because when he refers to the righteous, it's more the people who are thinking that they are righteous, right? It's not always those who are truly righteous. That sort of comes into focus with his interaction in Luke 7:36 to 48, where a Pharisee invites him over for lunch and isn't really hospitable in a typical Jewish way, right? The Pharisee invites him over for lunch, and Jesus arrives. He begins to recline at table, and who is the uninvited guest? It's the prostitute. And she comes in, and she pours out tears and washes Jesus' feet with her tears and dries them with her hair. She kisses his feet and anoints his feet. And all the while, the Pharisee is sitting there thinking, what kind of a prophet is this? I mean, doesn't he know who's touching him? And so before Jesus answers the question on his heart, he says, I'm going to tell you a story. Two men owed one individual. One owed 50 denarii, one owed 500 denarii. Neither could pay, and so the man forgave them both. Who do you think loved him more? And the Pharisee rightly answered, the one that was forgiven more. And then Jesus says, therefore I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But he who is forgiven little loves little. Now, is Jesus saying that the Pharisee doesn't have much sin? Or is it that she knows how much she's been forgiven, and the Pharisee doesn't get how much he needs that forgiveness? How many saints refer to themselves when you read their writings, even close to the end of their lives, how many of them describe themselves as the worst sinners, the chief of sinners, even though we know how holy they actually are. It's because they're aware of God's holiness and their sinfulness. And Jesus invites us through this first spiritual work of mercy to recognize our sinfulness. If we really understand our sin, if we appreciate the distance we have put between ourselves and God, then we will appreciate the mercy of God so much more. In Luke 5, we have this wonderful story about Jesus coming up to Peter, who's fished all night, and he asks if he can get into his boat so he can teach the people, and they push away a little bit. And after Jesus is done teaching, he says, let's go out deeper and let down your nets. And the catch is so full that Peter really sees through it all. And rather than grabbing a net and trying to help haul in the fish, he just hits the deck on his knees and says, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." And Jesus responds, "Depart from you. I want you to depart with me. I want you to follow me. Because if you know you're a sinner saved by grace, I want you to come catch fish, the men. I want you to catch men rather than be fishers of fish. Be fishers of men. Don't be afraid. Henceforth, you will be catching men." If we are to admonish sinners, we need to approach others in humility, aware that we are sinners saved by grace. I thought Jesus wanted to share the good news. Well, the good news is understood in light of the bad. The fact that we're sinners really isn't news at all. We just need to recognize it. In Luke 6:42, Jesus admonishes us, "How can you say to your brother, 'Brother, let me take out the speck that is in your eye,' when you yourself do not see the log that is in your own eye? You hypocrite. First take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye." He doesn't say the brother doesn't have a speck. It's just we need to do that work of mercy in our own lives. Let the Lord show us our sin, and then we can reach out to others. We are to admonish sinners. We don't judge the person, as Brant said from Luke 6:37, but we do speak to sinful actions. When we go to confession, are we receiving admonishment? Or is it really more of a spiritual attaboy, attagirl? I have 6 children, and there are many times that I went to confession, and somehow or another, I would work that in. I'm the mother of 6 children. And often, priests would say, "God love you. Wow. That is, you are doing so much." And when I went through my litany, and it was almost always the same sins, you know, impatience and being quick to anger and not listening carefully, etc., usually it was just like, "You're doing the best you can. Just try a little harder." And I would leave feeling a little bit self-justified. Well, one day I went to St. Peter's for confession. That's our church downtown. And there was a visiting African priest. And I probably even was sounding a little perfunctory, you know, going through the list. And he said, "Well, you must stop it." He said, "You have to be the image of the Blessed Virgin Mary in your home. Would she do these things?" Whoa. That was awesome. That was awesome. He was right to call me on the carpet. The Catechism in 1829 says that we are required, charity requires beneficence and fraternal correction. Now, fraternal correction is where we share one-on-one with a brother or sister in Christ, and it has to be done gently and with humility, but directly. We don't do everything well. We don't do everything correctly. And so if a brother or sister in Christ truly loves us, they will care enough about us to speak to us when they actually see us in wrongdoing. We regain a brother or we restore a relationship. James 5:20 says, "Whoever brings a sinner back from the error of his way will save his soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins." The second spiritual work of mercy is instruct the ignorant. From the outset of his ministry in Nazareth, Jesus said, quote, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor." Now, sometimes Jesus preached very plainly, like in Luke 4:43, "I preach the good news of the kingdom to the other cities also, for I was sent for this purpose." Very direct. This is why I'm here. But sometimes he spoke in parables that were confusing. They were parables about the kingdom of God. And in Luke 8, 9 to 15, he explains the scattering of the seeds and tells his disciples he's giving them the interpretation, but the people are not supposed to understand. When he's asked to teach the disciples to pray in Luke 11, 1, he gives them the Our Father. When Jesus comes to Jerusalem and he's teaching in the temple and the leaders really want to seize him and do away with him, they can't get very close to him because according to Luke 19, 47 and 48, the people were hanging on his every word. So instructing the ignorant is obviously something Jesus showed us. It calls us then to imitate. Romans 12, 2 is one of my favorite passages, and it says this: do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that you may prove what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. We will not know these things automatically. We have to keep renewing our mind. We are people of our culture. We are people of our nation. We don't always know the difference between being independent in a good way and being independent in a way that tears down the body of Christ, for instance, as an American. So how do we do this? We transform our minds by renewing them. That's part of why you're here, is to get new thoughts, new ideas, new ways of applying God's word in your life, in your family. We have given us, those of us who are parents, a responsibility to instruct our children in the faith. That's part of instructing the ignorant. The Catechism in 2225 says, quote, through the grace of matrimony, they receive the responsibility and privilege of evangelizing their children. It's not just teaching them about the faith, it's calling them on to a commitment to Christ, calling them on to know him and love him and serve him with their whole being. Teaching our children in the faith in our home includes praying together as a family and living the faith richly alongside them. And there's a lot of misinformation and malformation out there, so we need to get good materials into their hands. And for those of us with adult children, looking for good materials to help them teach their children. And then backing that up. One of my great privileges coming up is that my oldest granddaughter has asked me to be her confirmation sponsor at the end of August. And I'm so honored that Veronica would ask me. It's such a privilege to be able even just to witness her confirmation, but to actually be her sponsor is amazing. We do a lot of catechism in the car, at least we did when they were little. I'll give you just one example. We were driving down for Thanksgiving. All of our children were in the car. We have a big age spread, from 16 years spread, so probably was the last time we were all driving down with no one married. And my Joe was in second grade, but he had missed a lot of his answers on a particular chapter having to do with the person of Christ. So it was second grade, we're preparing him for First Communion, and I showed Scott that he had missed a lot of things about Jesus on this little test. And so he thought, okay, we're in the car, we call it catechesis, you know, we'll just do this in the car. So he began to do some instruction, everyone was listening, and then he said, now Joe, let me ask you a few questions. So would you say that Jesus is fully God? And he said, yes, yes, he is. And then from the back, we heard David go, yes, he is. Like, oh, what do you know? The little four-year-old's listening, okay. He said, is Jesus fully man? And Joseph said, yes, yes, he is. And then from the back, yes, he is. And then Scott said, is God eternal? And Joe said, yes. And from the back we hear, he is not. Like with all the definitiveness that a Han can speak about theology. And Scott said, what do you mean? And he said, I know what a turtle is. I've seen a turtle, and God is not a turtle. He was not going to be fooled. Lord have mercy. The third spiritual work of mercy is counseling the doubtful. After the transfiguration, Jesus comes down from the mountaintop with the disciples, and he finds that the disciples that had remained were unable to heal a little boy who had a demon that caused him to have seizures that were life-threatening. In Luke 9, 40 and 41, the father comes to Jesus and he said, I begged your disciples to cast it out, but they couldn't. And Jesus' response, not just to him, but even to the disciples, is, oh, faithless and perverse generation, how long am I to be with you and bear with you? Bring your son here. And the father hears this comment, and we have a little commentary on that. The Gospel of Mark adds some details. The father says to Jesus when he brings his boy over, if you can do anything, have pity on us and help us. And Jesus said, if you can, all things are possible to him who believes. And immediately the father of the child cried out and said, I believe. Help my unbelief. There was no pretense there. It's not that he had no faith, but it was weak faith. And that was enough of a real prayer. And Jesus heals that little boy. The father had doubts, but he was willing to doubt his doubts and profess at least the faith that he had. We're so quick to label Thomas doubting Thomas. And we look down our nose at him as if I were there, I would have believed the disciples. But I think we have to understand that he was brokenhearted. Like the other disciples, he had believed that Jesus was going to be around for a while. And when he died, it was so devastating and he was so confused and sorrowful that he said, I'm not going to believe unless I put my finger in his side. And Jesus, in his sweet accommodation to doubting Thomas, says, put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not be faithless, but believing. And Thomas's response is immediate, my Lord and my God. And Jesus says, he says something about us. He said, have you believed because you've seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. And that's us. To be able to counsel the doubtful, we need to pray. We need to ask the Holy Spirit, who is the counselor, for his gifts, because those include wisdom, understanding, and counsel, according to the Catechism in 1829. Second, we've got to prepare. It's part of why you're here. And for those of you staying for Defending the Faith, you're going to learn more apologetics. 1 Peter 3:15 says, always be ready to give a defense to anyone who calls you to account for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and reverence, end quote. Third, we need to listen to the heart of the person. Is their doubt a theological one, or is it a personal one? At the same time, we realize we have limitations. We cannot argue someone into obedience. A mind changed against its will is of the same opinion still. Fourth, we memorize scripture to have more at our fingertips to be able to share. Fifth, we may ask our spiritual director or a pastor, what's a better idea of how to share with others and when? Proverbs 19:20 says, listen to counsel and receive instruction that you may eventually become wise. And finally, maybe you want to invite that person to come with you to something, to a Bible study, to Mass, to RCIA, because I found as I was examining the Catholic faith, that it was easier for me to go and hear a presentation than to have the one-on-one contact with Scott over theological concerns, okay? Less confrontational, more invitational. The fourth spiritual work of mercy is to comfort the sorrowful. In Jesus' initial preaching in Nazareth in Luke 4:18, he's quoting Isaiah 6:1, which is, he came to heal the brokenhearted. In Luke 7, 12-15, this is such a beautiful passage, and it's almost, you get the sense that it wasn't planned, although there's no accident with our Lord. But Jesus is just passing by someone. And listen to what it says. As he drew near to the gate of the city, behold, a man who had died was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow. And a large crowd from the city was with her. When the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her and said to her, do not weep. Young man, I say to you, arise. And the dead man sat up and began to speak, and he gave him to his mother. Fear seized them all, and they glorified God, saying, a great prophet has arisen among us, and God has visited his people. Even though Jesus knew before he arrived in Lazarus' home, and at the tomb. After meeting Mary and Martha, he knew he was going to raise Lazarus from the dead, but he still wept at the tomb. Comforting the sorrowing is a ministry of presence. We need to draw near to them, listen to them, and share their sorrow. We have to risk it. One evening, I got a call from a friend who happened to catch the 6 o'clock news, and she said, "Do you know our mutual friend? Her husband was killed in a car accident today." And I was concerned, you know, if I called my friend, was I just gonna intrude on her family space? But I thought, you know what, I just need to let her know I'm with her. So I called her and I said, "This is so off the wall, but I just want you to know I'm praying for you, and is there anything I can do?" And she said, "Would you please come out to the house? I have to start going through his things, and I need someone with me." And so I just went out. We just sat cross-legged on the floor, and we started going through some of his personal things, and we laughed. She told me stories. We cried, and I was with her. Let's not get caught up in having all the right words to say, and whatever you do, don't say, "I know exactly what you're going through," because chances are good you don't. But that's not the important thing. It's acknowledging a loss. You hear of someone having a miscarriage or a stillbirth. You know what? If all you can do is get out tears, it's okay to just cry. It is. We are called to weep with those who weep. Some of you may be involved in Rachel's Vineyard, which is an amazing ministry, an outreach to men and women who realize the enormity of the loss of what has occurred through their abortion, and they're seeking forgiveness and restoration. If you hear of someone having a loss of a family member, take a moment to write a note. Place a call. Drop off some food. Is someone dealing with a very sick person, maybe a chronically ill person in their family, or someone suffering a divorce or abandonment by either a spouse or a child? Give them a call. Stop by. And ask the Holy Spirit. I love Romans 8:26. It says, "Likewise, the Spirit helps us in his weakness, in our weakness, for we don't know how to pray as we ought. But the Spirit himself intercedes with us with sighs too deep for words." What comfort it is to know that the Holy Spirit even can translate our groans and our cries before our Heavenly Father. The fifth spiritual work of mercy is bear wrongs patiently. In the Sermon on the Plain, Jesus says in Luke 6:22 and 23, "Blessed are you when men hate you, and when they exclude you and revile you and cast out your name as evil on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy. For behold, your reward is great in heaven, for so their fathers did to the prophets." Now we know across the world this is happening to Christian people. Jesus said, "If they hated me, they will hate you." For our soul's sake, we have to bear it patiently. But it can also be true of some non-Catholic Christians who choose to reject us when we become Catholic, or to neglect our friendship and let it just die, because it's easier to ignore us than perhaps to listen to the truth claims of the Catholic Church. We lost some friends when Scott became a Catholic, but I had a few people who said, "I'm hanging in there with you, Kimberly. You hang tough, you stay strong." And after 4 years, when I became Catholic, we lost more. Bill Bales, who spoke as one of our workshop presenters, didn't cut us off, but I visited he and his wife just a few months after Scott became Catholic. Actually, it was 1 year. It was 1 year after Scott became Catholic. And his advice to me, and we quoted in Rome Sweet Home, he said, "Really, you have grounds for divorce, Kimberly." And I didn't want to defend Scott because I didn't want to become Catholic. But I said, "I don't believe that that's true." And I gave him the defense. And about 4 months later, he called Scott and he said, "I owe you an apology." He said, "Would you please forgive me for telling Kimberly I thought she had grounds for divorce? What she shared is shaking me up, and I've got to talk to you about it." And as it turns out, I came in at Easter Vigil 1990. Bill came into the church in September. And in that process, I engaged his wife because I said, look, if I'm having to study these things and Bill's looking at these things, you've got to be my study buddy. And we got to figure out, is this something we're going to do or something we're not? And so we would study hard and then talk for 2 or 3 hours on the phone. And that spring after Bill came in, Scott and I were there witnessing when his wife, Lisanne, and their children were received into the church. Praise the Lord. Yeah. Jesus says in Luke 6, 27, but I say to you that hear, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who hurt you. We want to defend ourselves. We want to prove we're right. We haven't lost our minds. We haven't lost our faith. It is so counterintuitive instead to pray and to bear the difficulty patiently. But we need wisdom. You think of Father Hamel this week. Such long years of service in his mid-80s, filling in for another priest. And yet the Lord allowed him to offer his life. And we know that the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. I said to Scott, we've prayed so hard for this first daughter of the church, France. Maybe this is part to the answer to that prayer. I don't know if you caught it, but the French bishops have put out a call for a day of prayer and fasting. You think of all the priests and nuns that were slaughtered in the revolution, and yet what did the president of the country say? The death of a priest affects all of us. I'm so grateful that he knows that. Let's pray for the French people. We plant seeds and we trust God to work in his time to produce the harvest. And our responsibility, as Blessed Mother Teresa said, is not the fruitfulness that we see, but faithfulness, even when others wrong us. The sixth spiritual work of mercy is to forgive offenses. Jesus said in the Our Father in Luke 11:4, when he taught his disciples to pray, forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone who is indebted to us, and lead us not into temptation. Now Matthew 6, 14 and 15 adds this little commentary about what that actually means. Quote, for if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father also will forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Do you get that? That in every Our Father, we're praying, we're saying in Jesus, forgive me the way I forgive others. And if I don't forgive others, don't forgive me. That's scary, because we pray a lot of Our Fathers. So we've got to ask God to help us have his heart of forgiveness. From the cross, in the midst of the agony of the crucifixion, Jesus prayed, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they do. Luke 23, 24. And our mother prayed that. You know she united her heart to her sons. How did she forgive them while they abandoned her son, while they nailed her son, while they reviled her son, while they killed her son? But forgiveness is not a choice, and it is a choice. It's not based on feeling. I think of Corrie Ten Boom, who wrote The Hiding Place, about the fact that her family hid Jews in their World War II home in Austria before their family was taken to concentration camps, and both her father and her sister died there. She was speaking in Germany after the war about forgiveness, and the very guard that she held responsible for her sister's death came up to her and said, I'm so thankful for what you shared. Will you forgive me? And extended his hand. And everything in her recoiled. And in her heart, she said, Jesus, I can't do this. You will have to forgive through me. And the sheer act of her extending her hand, it was almost physical that she could feel the forgiveness of Christ flowing through her to that man. And we have that beautiful parable of the lost son, Luke 15:11-32, where the father's heart of forgiveness means he runs to him. He throws a robe of authority over him and puts the ring on his hand and celebrates his return. The seventh spiritual work of mercy is that we pray for the living and the dead. We know Jesus prayed all the time for the living. He continually withdraws from the public and the disciples. Luke 5:16, he withdrew to the wilderness and prayed. Luke 6:12, in these days he went out to the mountain to pray, and all night he continued in prayer to God. And I could really walk through probably almost every chapter where he was with the crowd and then he withdrew to get that just strengthening from God his Father to be able to continue to reach out to the people. Leading up to his passion, Jesus tells the disciples in the upper room of the dangers they are facing, but I have prayed for you. He also prayed for the dead. Before Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead, he prayed in John 11, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I know that you hear me always, but I've said this on account of the people standing by, that they may believe that you did send me. And when he said this, he cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. We pray for the living in imitation of Jesus' intercession for us. As a family, about every 6 months, we share a prayer concern, a major prayer concern for the next 6 months. And if anyone can't be there for Christmas or for our vacation, we ask ahead of time, what are you facing? And then we type up the list and share it with each other. And it is amazing to then look back after 6 months and realize how God has been at work so personally, so individually in our lives. It's powerful to keep track and watch God work. Even though we may not know specific names of persecuted Christians around the world, we can be one with them and pray for them, and we must. We pray for politicians, and I'm very grateful because now I am one. Last year we asked for prayer, and I was elected councilwoman at large here in Steubenville, and I am so grateful. Every time they pray, thank you. I think it's been the grace of God to me, the mercy of God to me, in all its different forms. But we pray for politicians, and I hope you will. We need to pray for pastors. I read recently, if you want a better pastor, pray for the one you have. Great thought. We need to pray for conversions in our families. About 30 years ago, Scott and I were having a conversation, and we realized we had stopped praying for his father's conversion. We didn't intend to. It's not like we thought, well, he's really not savable. There were just so many blocks. I think we just stopped praying. He was tall, handsome, accomplished, talented, wealthy, healthy. He did not see a need for God. And he said that he was an agnostic. He was hedging his bets. There might be a God, but it wasn't going to be the one. He wasn't going to try to pretend that he followed him. And he stopped going to church, even though he had been a church member. And it was hard. We'd visit with our little ones, and he just didn't want the pretense. And so he would send us off to church, and everyone would go but Dad. And so we repented of not praying for him. We loved him more than most people in the whole wide world. We needed to pray for him. And then God allowed his liver to fail. And in the humiliation and humility of losing his health, of not being able to work, of being needy, God worked in his heart and showed his power in the face of Dad's weakness. And he came to faith. What a joy. What a joy. Is there someone in your family that you've stopped praying for? Ask the Lord to show you and begin again. You have a natural love for that person. Let the Holy Spirit purify it. My father has pages and pages of names of people that he has committed to praying for, and it takes him more than an hour a day to pray for all the people he has committed to praying for. Now, we pray for the dead when we attend funerals, offer masses for the repose of someone's soul, walk through a cemetery and pray for the souls that we're walking by, when we go to an abortion mill and pray with, say, 40 days for life. At Mass, we're invited to pray for the departed, and I love it that our priest actually pauses, and there's like a minute in there, so I actually can go through the family lineup, because we're getting more and more on the other side of this life. And what a privilege to remember them in prayer, especially since all of our family are still not Catholic, except for one cousin's son and his wife. And so who else in the family would even think of praying for them? We need to pray for their souls. And then the holy souls in purgatory depend on our prayers, and it is good to pray for them, according to 2 Maccabees 12:46. Now, the spiritual works of mercy are an important work, but it doesn't preclude the corporal works of mercy. We don't pit souls versus bodies. We are embodied souls. And if we don't care for the people's needs around us, will they even be able to hear us share the gospel? If someone is cold or hungry or sick or imprisoned, can they hear us? So they're lesser needs, but they are real needs and maybe immediate needs. Dr. Robert Stackpole, who was one of our workshop presenters, wrote this about Blessed Mother Teresa of Calcutta. She used to say there are two kinds of real presence of our Lord in this world. The Lord's real presence in the Blessed Sacrament, where he fills us with his light, his life, and his love, and our Lord's real presence in the poor, both in those materially poor and those spiritually poor, where he is waiting for us to give him back his light, his life, and his love. So how do we do that? Well, there's seven corporal works of mercy. The first one is to feed the hungry. Jesus speaks of the obligation for us to, quote, share with him who has none, and he who has food, let him do likewise, in Luke 3:11. He illustrates this in the feeding of the 5,000. I mean, you think of that little boy having that just 5 loaves and 2 fish. That's all he had. He'd thought ahead, or his mother did. He had a meal, and there are 5,000 men plus women and children. So the disciples see the need. They've been away all day, no food that was distributed at least, and so they come to Jesus because they're concerned for the people. Send them away. And Jesus says, you feed them. So the disciples sort of take stock. We have 5 loaves and 2 fish. Unless we're to go and buy food for all these people. So Jesus takes the gift that he's given. He has the disciples tell the people to sit down, and then he looks to heaven, and notice the verbs used here. He blessed what he had been given, he broke it, and he gave it. And all ate and were satisfied, and there were 12 baskets left over. And then he went on later to teach that he was the living bread, because of course, once they got the physical bread, they were thinking, okay, this is good. This is a nice welfare program. Let's follow Jesus. He's gonna feed us. And he's saying, oh, this was only for a day, but I'm the living manna from heaven. I wanna feed you for life. How do we feed the hungry? We can bring meals to families who just had a baby or moved or experienced an illness in the family or death. We can invite others over to share in our Sunday dinner, college students or seminarians. We can invite our priest over for a home-cooked meal. Our son Gabriel and his wife one year made up bags, Ziploc bags, that had a sandwich, an apple, a small bag of chips, a water bottle, and a copy of Rome Sweet Home. And they got about 30 or 40 bags together, and they knew corners where there were homeless people. And so they would drive by, and one of them would jump out of the car and hand out a few bags, and then they'd keep going. And he had one left when I was visiting, and he said, Mom, we're gonna let you be the one to do the last one. And so we pulled up to the corner, and he said, okay, go. And so I jumped out of the car, and I ran over to someone, and I handed it to them, and I said, God bless you. And I got back in the car, and he, without looking, Gabe said, now I want you to look out and see who he is sharing that with. And sure enough, already it was being opened and shared right there. We can donate to a food pantry. We can help serve meals to the homeless at a soup kitchen, especially on a holiday. And we can offer produce from our garden to a neighbor or elderly person who can't have their own garden anymore, but love the fresh vegetables. Second corporal work of mercy, give a drink to the thirsty. In Mark 9:41, Jesus says, "For truly I say to you, whoever gives a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose their reward." And even though we know that John 3, the wedding feast of Cana, is really about launching Jesus' ministry and turning water into wine in anticipation of turning wine into his own blood in the Eucharist, there's such beautiful spiritual lessons. Let's be frank. He gave them something to drink. He gave the best wine for the people, rescuing the host of that wedding feast from hospitality disaster. We can give a drink to the thirsty by offering a cup of water to people working for us. We can contribute to building wells. There's a high school down in Tampa that found out if they could raise $3,000, they could give it to a diocese in Nigeria and they would have enough money to build a well. And of course, if you can build a well, you can give water, good water, to a whole village. They got so enthusiastic, they ended up raising $9,000. And so there were three wells that were possible with that donation. The third corporal work of mercy is to clothe the naked. Jesus says in Luke 3:11, "He who has two coats, let him share with him who has none." Jesus teaches the disciples that God will provide for your needs. In Luke 12:28 to 31, he says, "For if God so clothes the grass which is alive in the field today and thrown into the oven tomorrow, how much more will he clothe you, O men of little faith? And do not seek what you are to eat or what you are to drink, nor be of anxious mind. For all the nations of the world seek these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. Instead, seek his kingdom, and these things shall be yours as well." God will provide for our needs. And we are to help provide for others' needs, to clothe the naked by sharing the clothes that we have. For instance, maybe offering a business suit to a group of people who are helping people coming out of prison to look very sharp when they go for a job interview. Giving away clothes to Goodwill, contributing in our area to Coats for Kids, having baby showers. You know, that's a wonderful tradition of surrounding a young couple that probably doesn't have much money and being able to give them clothing for that little baby. Or lending maternity clothes. Maternity clothes can be so expensive. And so maybe you can clothe the naked by sharing a box of maternity clothes. Or collecting clothes for someone who lost everything in a fire or flood or disaster. The fourth corporal work of mercy is shelter for the homeless or welcome the stranger. Jesus received shelter at St. Peter's home, and there's the most beautiful church built over the home of St. Peter in Capernaum. In Luke 4:38 to 41, and I don't know why, I just get such, I find this so funny when I read this story. You know, Jesus shows up at Peter's home, and his mother-in-law lives there. We don't know if his wife still was living. We don't know if Peter was a widower or not, but his mother-in-law lived with him. How's that for a challenge, you know? And I am a mother-in-law, and I think very highly of mothers-in-law, but I still feel a little for each of them. But anyway, Peter had welcomed her into his home, and she was sick. Now, can you imagine? Jesus comes, and you're really, really under the weather. It said she had a high fever. What is her response? Well, Jesus figures out she has a high fever. He goes and immediately heals her. And what does she do? She immediately rose and served them. It's not like, "Oh, I'm so glad I feel better." It was, "Now I feel good enough to go and serve." And so what happens? Not only does she serve Jesus, but all day long, everyone who needed help came to their doorstep. Now, some of us have a limit. Some of us say, "You know what? I've had enough visitors." But here's this precious older lady just saying, "Bring it. I feel good. Let's let them come." And it says Jesus left the following day. So he was offered shelter there. The Good Samaritan provides shelter for the wounded man in Luke 10:34 and 35, taking him to an inn, paying for him there. How do we provide shelter? Maybe we open our home in foster care or adoption. We opened, Scott and me, we have opened our home to 42 students since we moved here in 1990. And just a few of the ones who've lived with us are Ted Sri, Michael Barber, Curtis Mitch, Curtis Martin, Tim Gray, and so many others. In fact, three priests who are now priests. We can welcome older family members to live with our family. We can contribute to a homeless shelter and perhaps visit them. Not just send a check, but go and talk with them face to face, demonstrating the dignity of their personhood. For our 25th wedding anniversary, we decided to do something really different. Instead of getting ourselves a gift, we decided to do a home build in Tijuana. We flew our family down, we paid for all the supplies, and we built a little two-room home for someone who had never owned a home in their lives. We can contribute to organizations helping house refugees, and we can contribute to organizations that help find housing for runaways, drug addicts, veterans suffering from PTSD, ex-prisoners, people who lost their home in financial crises, or people escaping an abusive home. And we can welcome a stranger. Now, sometimes I don't always remember who's been to our home. I went to a homeschool conference and I met a priest and I said, it's so nice to meet you. And he said, we've met before. And I said, really? Where did we meet? And he said, when I came to your house for dinner. And I turned to the other priest who was with him and I said, have we met before too? And he said, I spent the night. Oh, well. The fifth corporal work of mercy is visiting the sick. Everywhere Jesus went, he healed the sick. In Luke 10:30-37, the Good Samaritan cares for the stricken man and pays for more care for him. How can we visit the sick? We can volunteer at a nursing home or hospital. My oldest son, Michael, and his family just moved from South Bend, but for the last 2 years, they had gone to a nursing home and visited at first just one elderly lady, and then as they came in with all their little ones, more people came out in the hallway and they began to make more friends. And they had a number of friends, and the children, the little children, talk about their various friends with their first name. All through this pregnancy, as they went back, this is their fifth baby, they would pray for Anna, and they were so excited. And when I was out helping with the new baby on that Saturday, the day he was actually going to be baptized, the whole family went with this days-old baby to show all of the people at the nursing home this child that they had all prayed for. We can stop by a housebound elderly neighbor or a friend's home to offer company, conversation, and some practical care. We can relieve a caregiver of someone who is caring for someone who's chronically ill. We can be a Eucharistic minister and take the Eucharist to them. If you're a doctor, dentist, or nurse, you can go on a medical mission. And as a mother-in-law and a mother, I have offered to go and help with the new babies. And it is real help. The sixth corporal work of mercy is visiting prisoners. Jesus said in Luke 4:18, he has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed. At my Uncle Doyle's funeral, one man stood up and he said, I learned to be a pastor from Doyle Snyder. He said, I was an assistant, and we had a murder in our neighborhood of Bellevue over in Pittsburgh, and someone had been arrested immediately. He said, I went to church that day, and I couldn't find Doyle, and I asked where he might be, and what had happened was my uncle had gone to church that day and called down to the jail, and he said, is anyone visiting this man? And they said, no, and he said, would you ask him if he would receive a visitor? And he was very eager to have a visitor. And so my uncle wasn't at church because he was down at the jail trying to speak the love of Christ to that man. When we went out to Allentown one year, Scott and I were having a luncheon with the bishop before we were going to speak that evening. And all of a sudden it hit me that there were pro-lifers from Steubenville in the Allentown State Prison. And I said, Scott, we can visit real prisoners that we know. Now, at that time, we didn't have to have a driver's license to fly, so we didn't have them. We asked the bishop, could you make a call for us? And he did, and he said that we could go. So we took a copy of Rome Sweet Home, I'm not kidding you, and we showed them the photo on the back and said, this is us, and they let us in. And we had the privilege of meeting first with the four men and then with the four women. They were in prison only because they had been to abortion mills and had dismantled a machine. And yet they were with the most hardcore criminals who had done child abuse and murders. And it was such a privilege to be with them, to give them words of encouragement. There is so much more I can say, but I'm going to have to wrap it up. Seventh is the corporal work of mercy of burying the dead. Jesus actually didn't have to, because he kept raising them. But this is a Christian act of charity to bury the dead. And if you get to Rome, I would really encourage you to go to St. Pudenziana and St. Praesedes churches, because they're churches named for two sisters who were the daughters of Senator Pudens, actually mentioned in the book of Romans in Romans 16. And there's a beautiful mosaic of them going out on the field after these Christians have been slaughtered and gathering up their bodies for burial. They ended up being martyred as a consequence of their faith. And there are wells in both churches that for a time held the bones of Christian martyrs until they could be buried. What can we do? Participate in funeral services, sing and serve, contribute to the burying of the bodies of aborted babies, and visit the cemetery. How can we be evangelists of mercy? We need to care for our families, for the household of faith, and reaching out to those who do not know the Lord. Like the loaves and fish, we don't have a lot to offer. But you know what Jesus says? I just want it all. And then I will do the impossible with it. St. Jose Maria Escrivá says in Friends of God, mercy means keeping one's heart totally alive, throbbing in a way that is both human and divine, with a love that is strong, self-sacrificing, and generous. Let's pray that God will work through us, through the spiritual works of mercy and the corporal works of mercy, so that we may hear Jesus say, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your master.